So hi guys, welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, my name is Hetfi, and in this video I'll be discussing how you could go about constructing your lab report. Now somewhere on your screen now you'll find a timeline that will go through each of the subsections that I will be going through in this video, beginning with a brief introduction as to what a lab report is. For those of you that are unaware, don't worry, I'll go through exactly what a lab report is and the importance of constructing one, followed by looking at how to construct your lab report and each of the subsections you want to incorporate within your lab report and the importance of those, and then finally to conclude with just a few tips that you should bear in mind when you're constructing your lab report in order to make sure that you're gaining maximum amount of marks and not making, more importantly, those silly mistakes that could cost you a couple of marks or even a grade. So without further ado guys, let's dive right into today's video. So a lab report essentially is accounting for what you have conducted your experiment on, as well as what you discover during that experiment. So there are three primary reasons why you may have a lab report to construct. Number one, being able to communicate across what it is that you're investigating and what you have found through your results and data presentation. Number two is to then analyze those results. And number three is to then draw conclusion as to, you know, what the experiment suggests, the importance and the relevance of that experiment. So bearing these three elements in mind is what will allow the reader to gain an insight into what it is that you're experimenting, what it is that you're trying to find, you know, what the current research is revolving around that study or around that topic that you have chosen, as well as being able to then carry out the method that you have to gain the same or the similar results to what you have gained. So you should aim to, you know, cover these three elements in order to ensure that you have created a successful lab report. Coming to each of the subsections and what you want to encompass within each of the subsections within your lab report, beginning with introduction. Now, whenever I'm constructing an introductory paragraph, I always like to think of it as being like an inverted triangle. And the reason for this is that you want to start off your introductory paragraph with a more generalized overview of the subject matter. And then you want to start to narrow down your focus to that particular aspect that you're wanting to investigate or do your research on, but also why it is that your research is important or relevant to that particular topic that you are wanting to gain a bit more insight in or knowledge in. So whatever that might be, you want to always start your introductory paragraph more generalized and then kind of narrow your focus towards your hypothesis and kind of the importance of your research. It's what I'm trying to state. Now, once you've got your hypothesis and, you know, you've nailed your introductory paragraph, you want to focus on your method. Now, unless and otherwise stated that you've already been given a particular method that you should be doing your research on, you want to start reading around different journal articles or, you know, research articles that are relevant to the particular aspect you're wanting to research and see how they have constructed their method. You know, how is it that they found those different elements of their hypothesis to either prove or disapprove their hypothesis? Right? You could use some of their methods in order to investigate your hypothesis, bearing in mind that your hypothesis will not be the same as those that have already, you know, done their research. It will be different and therefore your method will not be exactly the same. So bear in mind that just because you found one article that's investigating something similar does not mean your method will be identical. There will be some differences between them, and it's important that you're able to find those differences and, you know, ensure that your method is relevant to your hypothesis. Now, when you come about to write your methods, what I will state is don't begin writing your method until and unless you have already started to do some lab work and you've actually, you know, done that method at least once. Now, the primary reason for this is that, you know, when you're doing your investigation, when you're carrying out, your method in the lab, what you will find sometimes is that you do not have the appropriate equipment, you do not have the appropriate reagents, or you do not have sufficient amount of the reagents, so therefore you use alternatives, right? So, you know, in your method section, if you haven't mentioned those alternatives, if someone else was to carry out your method as in how it was, they will get different results from you. So it's very important that you've at least done your method once, you know, you've carried it out, you've done it once, and then you start your write-up, because you'll know exactly what changes you've made. You can then incorporate them within your method to, you know, translate exactly what you've done in the lab and how you've gained those results. Now, one thing I would want to mention here is that when you're doing your write-up, make sure that you're using third person unless otherwise stated, if they want it to be first person or they want you to use personal pronouns. But usually when you're doing a lab report, it's always third person, or in general when you're doing coursework, it usually is third person unless otherwise stated likewise. So bear that in mind, and it should be in past tense. So bear these two factors in mind when you're writing your method. And the other thing I did want to mention when you come to write up your method is that do not be extremely detailed, right? You want to be short, concise, but accurate. You do not want to tell them about how many times you had to wash your hands during the experiment. You do not want to mention how many test tubes you've had to use. I would state that, you know, if you're using test tubes or if you're using apparatus that you feel one should kind of be more informed of, maybe try incorporating diagrams to illustrate, you know, the format or the organization of your equipment and your apparatus, you know, just to give them a bit more idea as to, you know, how to set up the equipment or, you know, how many equipment they require. Because remember, at the end of the day, when you're doing your lab report, you will have a word limit that you've got to try and be within when you're constructing your lab report. So you don't want to use too many words that you could use otherwise in your discussion when you're actually critically analyzing your results. So, you know, try and make sure that it's very short, concise. Use diagrams where appropriate to demonstrate the equipment, the apparatus, the setup. You know, if you're doing serial dilution, for example, you know, you might want to use a diagram to demonstrate how you've serially diluted, you know, the reagent and the substances. You know, so think of alternatives that you can use in order to not only enhance your lab report, but also to make it much more clear and concise for the reader to gain an understanding of how it is that you've actually done that experiment. Right, so now moving from our method section to our results. Now results are fairly simple, right? You're only demonstrating what you have gained. There should be no references within your results section, nor in your method, unless of course you're using a method that someone else has constructed or that someone else has already used, right? Otherwise, there should be no references either in your methods or your results section. Now, your results section in particular is going to be illustrating what you have gained from your experiment. So it will have data that you have gathered, whether that is in a table form or a graph, that's completely your choice. Right? But you want to make sure that you are not changing any of your results and that you're being as honest as you can with, you know, how your data is presented. You know, just to make it more favorable for your hypothesis, you know, you shouldn't be changing any of your results. Sometimes when you're doing your practicals, you'll find that your results aren't always going to be in favor of your hypothesis. So don't feel like if you don't get favorable results for your hypothesis that you've done it wrong or that it's inaccurate. Sometimes you will get results that are completely contradictory to what you've hypothesized, right? You want to then start to critically analyze that result and demonstrate what that could suggest. I would say that usually if you have you know, results that are as a table or as a graph, they're much more visually stimulating, allows the reader to see where the correlations may be. So I definitely state use visual stimuli. That will definitely help and aid the reader in understanding what it is that you found. Now, moving to discussion. Now, this is your time to shine because here you will be critically analyzing your own data. Now, you could use the aid of other journal articles that may either favor or be contradictory to what you've gained. And that will show that you have gained a holistic idea and an overview of, you know, what your data suggests. So I'll definitely state that make sure that you're using other journal articles, other references that have investigated same or similar to what you have investigated, what that might suggest, right? And how that could be used for further research. So you also want to look at factors like how that research could further enhance and help society. So, you know, why is it that that research was important to conduct? It's something that you've already mentioned in your introductory paragraph, but you want to also relate that back in your discussion. Now, one thing I want to discuss when you are critically analyzing is that you want to add your own opinion to it. Add how you could improve your research. Where do you think the changes may be necessary? Where do you think, you know, you could have made an error that could have led to unfavorable results or results not being statistically significant, right? Human error is one of those, right? You are likely to make a mistake, whether that is pipetting or, you know, sampling or analyzing. So refer to those to showcase that you have holistically thought through this and that you haven't just looked at the results itself, but you've also looked at how to improve those results, where those mistakes could have been that led to the results not being statistically significant as they could have been. Now, finally, to your conclusion, this is where you will summarize your key findings and what you want the reader to take home. It's not an opportunity for you to be introducing any new information or any new topics, right? So be sure that your conclusion is short, a couple of sentences, no more, but it summarizes the lab report as a whole. And something that I haven't really mentioned, nor have I stated, is the need for an abstract. Now, this will vary depending on what your institute or your university states it requires. Some will state that you require an abstract when you're constructing your lab report, some will not mention it. So, you know, make sure that you check your assignment brief and your marking criteria whether or not an abstract is necessary. But an abstract is essentially a summary of your entire lab report as a whole. It's different from your conclusion because in your abstract, like a blurb that you have at the back of a book, it will state each and every single subsection that you have within your lab report from your introduction to your conclusion. And it's just a nice summary, no more than a sentence or two, of what each of those subsections will entail. And that's why I didn't mention it till the very last, because an abstract is something that you should construct after you've completed your entire lab report from your introduction to your conclusion. Because it's a summary of what each of those subsections have, if you have completed those subsections beforehand, it becomes so much easier to then summarize each of those subsections. Trying to do it the other way with having your abstract done before your introductory paragraph or before any of the other subsections makes your life a lot more difficult. Trust me with that. So make sure that you've actually done each of the other subsections before you start your abstract, and your abstract would be located before your introductory paragraph. So some of the tips that I want you to take home with you, number one being that when you're doing your results section, make sure that you're correctly labeling your axes. So be sure that when you're, you know, constructing your graph or that diagram, you're looking at, you know, how you've labeled it, whether or not those units have been included. Number two is, again, when it comes to your results section, make sure that you know when to use a figure legend and when to use a table heading. Although it sounds pretty simple, you'll be shocked and surprised as to how many individuals kind of misunderstand when to use a figure legend or a table heading. So when you have a table, you know, a table heading is usually above the table that you've presented, and it is just a brief description of what your table presents. A figure legend, on the other hand, it demonstrates, you know, what those, you know, graphs, diagrams illustrate, and it's usually underneath the diagram or the graph that you've presented. And be sure that any tables, charts, graphs that you've used are actually referenced in your text. And finally, number three is, in terms of referencing, because you're doing a lab report and, you know, it's about your own investigation, your own experiment, the amount of references you have will be relatively less in comparison to other courseworks that you may have done. So, you know, your references should be, in this case, limited to your introductory paragraph and your discussion, right? You might have a few in your method section if you've used method that other researchers have used, but make sure that you're, again, appropriately referencing them where and when you've used them. But your references otherwise should be limited to your introductory paragraph, where you're providing kind of that general overview of that subject matter or that topic that you've chosen, and in your discussion, where you're comparing your results to other researchers' results, right? You shouldn't have them in your results section, nor should you have them in your conclusion, because in your results section, it's your data that you're presenting, and in your conclusion, it's a summary of your lab report, so you should not have any references there either. So guys, that is it for this video. I really hope you found this video useful. If you have, guys, be sure to like this video, subscribe if you haven't already, and hit that bell icon right next to it to make sure that you're regularly updated. If there are any questions or queries, guys, like always, drop them in the comments section and I'll try my best getting around to answering as many as I can. And till next time, guys, take care. Bye!